Okay, the first thing that you're going to do when you open up the joe.jpg image is actually duplicate it so that you'll always have a fresh copy of the original image you downloaded. And there's two ways that you can do this through Photoshop. One is to simply go to the top image menu, click on that, and come down to the duplicate command. And what this will do is open up the duplicate image box, and it will automatically append the word copy to the original file name. And you can leave that there or actually change the whole name and click OK. And that will open up a brand new image alongside of your original image. Now, be sure to save this copy image if you want to use it. I'm going to close it out right now and show you the other way to duplicate an image that will actually put away the original image and give you a new image. So click the close box on this one, and I'm going to say no because I'm going to show you this alternate way. With the original image highlighted, we can go to File and down to the Save As command. And when the Save As dialog box opens up, in order to create a duplicate image of this, and notice how it's opened up the window and put it in the same location where you got it. It's already navigated there for you. In order to duplicate the image, if we were to hit Save right now, it would overwrite it. So we're going to click in the file name window here, right before the period, and I'm just going to type an underscore and just type WK1 for work 1 and leave the .jpg and click save. And so now this is going to save that file in the same directory or folder on your desktop unless you've moved it, and it's going to open up the JPEG options dialog box. Now it opened up and set it automatically to a quality of 10. This is a hint. This is what this image was saved at for you to download. And so you're going to click OK. You're going to leave it at 10. This is not going to hurt the image at all because no information is changed. Click OK. And now what that does, notice up here the title bar of this image has now updated to be Joe Work 1 JPEG and closed the original image. So this is our working image. If I click on the bridge icon here, we can see that it has added it to that folder along with the original image. Just collapse bridge here and come back to this. And now we're going to talk about setting up some other preferences in Photoshop before we begin adjusting this image. Come over to your toolbar down to the eyedropper tool and select it, just the eyedropper tool. Now in the top options bar it says sample size point sample. What does that mean? Well, that means when we use the eyedropper to click an area of the image, notice how the foreground color updates to where we clicked. And it's very subtle, but at point sample it's just analyzing that very exact point or pixel that the eyedropper clicked on. For high-res images, you want to do an average of those pixels, and I'm going to show you why by zooming in on the image. So we're going to be doing some color correction here, so I'm just going to zoom in on a very small part of that cheek and go in even more. I'll go up to 1600. I'll swipe down here at the bottom of the document window and just type in 1600% and then use my space bar. But hopefully the video will show you that zoomed in at these great amounts that what you're seeing is comprised of tiny little squares. So a point sample would be just one of these squares, even though the color that you see when it's zoomed out is a mix of those. So for example, if I clicked on this area right here, to be more accurate, I would need it to take a sampling of a larger area. And you can do that by changing the sample size to 3x3 average or 5x5 average. on this particular resolution of an image. I'm going to use 3x3 average. And so what that basically does is it analyzes in a 3x3 grid, takes 3 pixels across, 3 pixels down, takes that big chunk, a total of 9 pixels, and wherever you sample, if you sampled right here, it would take those surrounding pixels and average that color for you when you click. I'm going to go under View and say Fit on Screen again. And we're setting this up not so much to select color from right now, but we're going to be using some eyedropper controls in our Levels dialog box to adjust the color balance, contrast, and tone of this image, or the dynamic range. Also, while I'm here, and this is part of the intro to show you some basic information, remember when we were in Bridge, how we looked at the file properties information and the EXIF data? You can look at that in Photoshop too, and where you go for that is under the File menu down to File Info. And let me put this over here. This is where you would input information for your own original files as well. So I put all this information in here and put in my keywords, etc., and the copyright information, and that's listed here. The EXIF data for the camera would be accessed by clicking on the camera data fields over here. Again, it will tell you specific information about the EXIF data that the camera had by clicking on these states. If you have images that you are going to copyright with the same location and same keywords, etc., or you could just delete this stuff here. If you want to save a template file, what you do is fill it in on your file information, and you might want to make it more generic than this is. So for example, you may not want a description in it or keywords at this point, but this area down here, copyright information that you put in, once you have that set up, you would click this flyout arrow at the top of the box. Let me move this over so you can see. And you would select Save Metadata Template. This is also where you would go if you wanted to delete a particular metadata template on a file. But if you wanted to save a template, you would click it here, and then it would be listed. Notice all of the different templates that I have saved under here. I'm just going to click Cancel out of here. The other thing I wanted you to remember when we were looking at that information in the file properties in Bridge was the file size of this image. It said 1.2 megabytes. Now, if we go under the image size dialog box, I'm going to show you this anomaly here. The pixel dimensions are listed as being 28.7 megabytes. Well, that's a lot bigger than 1.2 megabytes, isn't it? Well, this is the file size based on a TIFF file format, an uncompressed file format. And so when you actually open up the image in Photoshop, it is at a larger size because it is uncompressed. When it's saved and stored on your hard drive, it's in that compressed state because JPEG compresses it to take up less file room. But when you open it up, it is actually larger. But this dimension here, the 28.7 megabyte, is based on if you saved it as a TIFF file format, which is a lossless compression algorithm. But your image at this point while it's open is taking up this much room in Photoshop. So just wanted to clarify that in case you did notice that anomaly or wondered about this. I'm going to click Cancel and expand this a little bit here too. At the bottom of our document window, I have listed currently by choice the embedded color profile. But if you click this little arrow, oops, I'm going to have to move this up a bit so you can see it. Let me shrink this window up by clicking the lower right-hand side of the document window and click this area here. You can determine what information you want to show in that bottom bar. Right now I have document profile. If I wanted document sizes, I could click this, and that's what the default is. And notice it is saying 28.7 megabytes. That's because we've opened it up. But when we close it and save it as a JPEG again, and if it's flattened, it will be compressed down to that much smaller file size. Go back here to show. I like to have my document profiles in that area because I can find other information by using a keyboard shortcut. Holding down your Alt key on a PC or Option key on a Mac and clicking this little bottom bar here will open a pop-up window which will quickly give you the pixel dimensions as well as the inches dimensions and the color mode and the resolution of the document currently. So we've set up our eyedropper for 3x3 average. The next thing I want to do is manipulate some of my palettes over here, the workspace area. And in CS3, these panels are very nice, and they're collapsible too. If you wanted more space, this is the default workspace. Again, you find that under Window Workspace and go to Default Workspace. You can set up custom ones too, but for now, we're just going to work with the default. These little hash marks at the top, notice when I hover over it gets double arrows, so that means I can squish that in a little bit. If I click on the double arrows over here, it's going to collapse it even further to give me just the names of the palettes. And if I take this one and expand it a little bit, I can see the names of these palettes as well. Or I can collapse it even further once it's in that name view and just squish it over there, which is what I'm going to do. After a period of time, you'll recognize what these particular little icons stand for as far as what palettes they will open up. But without memorizing, if you just hover over them for a second, a little yellow tooltip box will open up and tell you what they're for. That's actions. What we're concerned with in this video are the following layers, this right here. So I'm going to click on that because I want layers to open up. And then I'm going to take it out of this docking area. Right now, as soon as I click outside, it's going to collapse. If I want that palette to stay open, I want to de-dock it. So I'm going to grab the Layers tab and just pull it away from that right-hand area. And then I can collapse this panel just by clicking on that tab. The other palette that we're going to be using is the Info palette. So that has the little eye icon here, so I'm going to click that to open it up, and then I'm going to drag the Info tab away from that panel, like so, and then the Histogram palette we are also going to use, so I might as well grab that. And I can dock that with the Info palette out here if I like and de-dock it later. And that's about it for now, what we're going to be using in here. Let's talk about the Info palette. Right now I have this set up K, which is really grayscale, and I'm going to set it back to the default, which probably will be RGB. There's another readout over here, and yours may say RGB. I'd like you to change it to CMYK. I always like to have two different color models in the Info palette showing, and that's either going to be RGB and CMYK, or I may have the grayscale one up here. But for right now, I'm just going to set that to RGB.